Ready?
Let's do it. Hopefully no technical difficulties.
You're making me laugh. I don't know what to do, Maddie, half the time. All I know is
just rolling in here.
All I know is as season two comes to an end, you are still a host in training because you're unable to announce the show and walk in this amazing drum line and say, we are back for another edition of Laugh.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Laugh Monday Night Madness. All right. Welcome to the show, everyone. I feel like you're just a better introducer.
Why?
I see we're sticking with the old music still.
It's not season three yet, Maddie.
It's not season three yet, you're right.
Everything is organized.
It's still in season two.
The thing is, Maddie, is like when you introduce something, right? You gotta just kind of like find something and take that little rhythm and just keep diving deeper and deeper and deeper and say, so Maddie, how are you doing this morning?
It's this afternoon. Good afternoon there. 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
As you know, Maddie, time is irrelevant to a guy like me.
You're right. Yeah, this guy wakes up. He just told me he slept in today. Tell them what time you slept in until.
4:50 a.m.
Insane.
You know, listen to this part. This is part of the song. I love this. Bass players,
why don't you do that part in the beginning?
That's cool, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, I was like, what the? Like, I was goofing around on this. This is like, bam, bam, bam. And we are back!
Bobby's been acting like DJ, MC, host.
I know. I gotta calm down.
We were testing different voices before we came on.
Yes. We came up with a voice for Maddie's head. Like, if I get stuck inside Maddie's head, this is what I think I begin to sound like.
When I repeat the question.
Hi, Maddie. Hi. There you go, Maddie.
Hi, Madison. Bobby.
Did you know that the
I'm just happy if my microphones work. I'm actually using my microphone today. I'd just like to put that out there. You see that little green?
Yes.
We're using it.
Madness, do you know the 10-year bond is actually improving today?
I do. I've been getting some repricing notifications.
Do you know why that is?
Bobby, tell me. Enlighten me. I honestly can't make sense of this stuff anymore.
They say it's because the auction has been pretty plentiful. I like to talk very like biblical when I talk to this voice. It's been a plentiful auction for all.
You sound like you're recording an audiobook. You're some like very serious... Like, I don't know, it's a serious book. It's not like a little rom-com or something.
Yeah, man. All right, guys. Well, we are here and we are putting together another episode of Madness with Laugh, Lend, and Eat. See, I switched that up for you.
I like it. See? Instead of eating madness, that's
we've come a long way from eating madness. This could be Madness powered by Laugh, Lend, and Eat. Ooh.
I like it. Well, actually, I just opened an LLC finally.
Did you really?
And guess what the name of my LLC is?
No. You really?
Guess.
By Fobby? LLC?
No. Just Madness. LLC. Because I have so many things umbrellaed under Madness at this point. That it's been a long time coming for that, but I was like, what do I call this? And then I was like, just Madness.
Madness. It kind of sounds, in all honesty, it kind of sounds like the current market that we're in.
It does. That's why we call me Mortgage Madness.
When you really, really think about what's going on, the market has been in utter madness. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like the bad side of the madness.
Yeah, not the good side. I mean, we can't really make any predictions that are worthwhile making. And our good friend Barry Habib found that out. He was very generous with his statements a few weeks ago where he acknowledged that the whole May 10th thing wasn't as smart of an idea as maybe he could have been. But, you know what I mean? You live by the sword, die by the sword. And he was man enough to accept that. So, but the cool thing is that we are in a market where I am seeing something that is really interesting that I haven't seen in almost 30 years.
What's that? Which is
people exiting because there's a slowdown in the market and they don't have any hope that it'll ever go back up again. Like the hope is absolutely gone.
Gone. You know what I mean? And it's not just mortgage people either.
Yeah.
It's title.
Can I do something real quick? Can I do something real quick?
Yeah.
Hang on a second.
You're allowed.
Hey, John.
Hey, what's up, bud?
Hey, we're recording a podcast right now. You're on the show right now.
Oh, great.
Yeah, since you weren't here to actually do our production for us, I figured I'd put you on the show.
We've had 16 technical difficulties. Where the F are you?
So you're being recorded right now to go live on the show right now.
Yeah, who's the guest?
You wouldn't guess who it is. It's madness. Who else?
Look, JP, I'm representing him today. He should be on the show.
I can imagine she's ranting about something.
She's ranting about you not being here because we've had so many technical difficulties.
You want me to hop on? I've got time.
Sure, come on.
I'm on.
Come on down.
As I was saying.
Oh, God, what was I even saying?
You can tell we're coming to the end of the season, can't you? Like, all the wheels of the car, like, falling off.
Yeah. Bobby told me one of my topics I wanted to talk about was boring tonight. So we're just going to make it interesting. We're just keep spicing things up.
No. What I want to know is, you're in the market. You're on the grassroots way more than I am. You know what I mean? Unfortunately, every time I think about actually originating loans, I never get the energy to actually do it. Mm-hmm. I'd love to go back to origination somehow. I don't know how, but I'm going to figure this out. What I want to ask you, Madness, is what are you doing to stay relevant? Since you're such an artistic person, and I know that your artistic is being like cramped and dampened in this market, and you can't really release the entire madness, right?
In some ways, yes.
you're like in shock.
I was about to cough, and then I'm like, oh my God, the microphone's actually working today.
What do you do to stay relevant?
Well, a couple things. I mean, I think I've said this over and over again, maybe every episode, but it's not that I don't pay attention to the rates, because that's like a careless thing for me to say, but it's not the thing that I focus on to see whether or not my business is going to do well that month or in that quarter. So right now I am trying to, and it sounds like cheesy and I feel like it's almost overdone, but like I'm really, really, really focusing on building relationships right now.
Hmm.
So a couple things. I joined a networking group.
Mm-hmm.
So with this networking group, it's called La Tip. But basically there's one person from every industry. So I think it's really important. La Tip, L-E, and then T-I-P.
La Tip.
Mm-hmm. I'm saying like le.
Wasn't there a song like this back in the 70s called La Freak?
Maybe.
I think there was
song. I was like 20 years before my time.
So you're now part of a networking group that's called La Tip.
Yes.
Is this a legitimate networking group or just something you guys made up?
Oh, no, it's legitimate. Like, I feel like I'm just learning the ropes. I had to get voted in. I had to show up to two meetings.
You had to bring donuts?
No. We meet half in person, half virtual, and then they have a bunch of networking events. And it kind of it's sorority fraternity-like. Like, there's, you know, like the chapter president and things like that.
When one half is in person, does the other half know that it says virtual?
No, it's like you have to be there in person or you have to be there virtually. I feel like I missed something there.
You always so focused on the question.
I know. I'm like, what did he say? Did my eyebrow raise?
A little bit, not a lot. You were just like, okay, I've got to fix this one right now. Yeah. So you're part of this networking group, right?
Yeah.
And you're using this to strengthen business relationships, I guess. Is that what it's all about?
Strengthen business relationships because, look, at the end of the day, if your only referral source is a real estate agent, mm-hmm. I'd love to sit down and talk with you right now. If you're doing well and your only way of getting leads right now.
Got to cut you off. You just said the magic word.
What?
And I'm going to go down a rabbit hole. Real estate agents.
Okay.
Dude, you're in New Jersey.
Oh, yeah. Are you going to talk about the...
So your neighboring state is New York.
Mm-hmm.
Did you hear what happened in the state of New York with the Real Estate Agents Association? Effective January 1st, 2024, sellers can no longer pay the buying agent the commission. That's the new law.
Really?
In the state of New York. Yes, I wouldn't
make
that.
I didn't hear that.
Oh, yeah. This is huge. Because this goes in conjunction with the lawsuit that's happening in Kansas last week, that started in Kansas, where NAR, National Association of Real Estate Agents, are being sued in a class action lawsuit right now in Kansas City. I can't remember the numbers, but like billions of dollars. Maybe JP can Google this for us.
Oh, yeah.
He's logged
on.
JP,
we need the brains.
But it's like billions of dollars, and they're saying that the selling agents should not have been paying the buying agents this entire time. That if the buyer wants to make commission, the buying agent wants to make commission, they need to get it from the buyers themselves, not the sellers. Now, I just want you to understand, well, before our little post-episode talk, and okay. I was telling you that I feel like more loan officers are losing hope, and kind of
yeah.
walk into that.
Yeah.
These are all the things that I'm seeing that are affecting, because it's a seismic shift if this thing actually goes into play. Now, New York did it, so I would imagine that a few other states that I can list off the head that I don't want to piss off, I won't mention their names right now.
The states, you want to miss the states pissing you.
Yeah, I know you're good for that. I don't need to piss off states. I travel too much.
I piss off my own state. I've divided us. All right, keep going.
So you mentioned real estate agents getting real mm-hmm. estate, like, and very smartly, you said we need to find sources outside of real estate agents, because in the foreseeable future, if these laws continue going through state legislations and this lawsuit prevails in Kansas City against NAR, buying agents will be like the dinosaurs.
Yeah.
Buyers.
I mean, I already see it so much, like, even, you know, not to even cut you off, but with buyer, like, no one wants to be a buyer's agent right now.
Why not?
Because you're not going and looking at, let's just say, I'd say, like, average person right now, I think I looked this up the other day, you're seeing, like, the average number of homes that you see before purchasing is about 15.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, it's about double that.
Yeah, I actually heard 44, but yeah.
Yeah. So, or at least double that.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no promise that after going and doubling that number, that client's either going to get an offer accepted, going to still have, you know, the hope that we keep kind of coming back to, that it's still worth it to continue looking after, you know, losing not even multiple bids, but, you know, 20 bids. How much hope is there, and how much promise is there for that buyer's agent that keeps going out there, gas, time,
but
money?
You're smart. You know what I mean? And I've always said that about you, but I say publicly, you know what I mean? That you're going out, you're creating networks and relationships outside the traditional methodology that so many loan officers have been like, I can't tell you. Like,
when I say this to other loan officers, they're like, what do you mean? We need agents. What do you don't cut off the agents. It's like, I'm sorry, but that just can't, it's not sustainable.
Yeah. I mean, look, I think there was a prediction made by me and a few other people, I think within the last 24 months, that we could see in the next 5 years where loan officers would be giving leads to agents. So
I mean, that's how it used to be. And again, not from my own experience, but when I talk to title agents, insurance agents, other loan officers that have been doing this for longer, it seems like social media and technology has almost made the buyer the agent And so the buyer already comes into the agent knowing what they want mm-hmm. before they're even approved.
So, question, so kind
of flip things.
If you want to our job difficult. If you wanted to buy a house
mm-hmm.
and your state passed the law saying you now have to pay the commission to the buying agent, you, Madison Keenan, and you want to buy a
I'm not using an agent.
Why not?
On top of down payment and closing costs and just knowing, you know.
Why not?
I'm not me personally, but I'm saying this is going to be the mentality. Are you talking about me personally?
I'm talking about you personally.
I'm biased at this point because I'm in the industry. So I believe that there's a professional that's going to do it right and do it better than myself.
You really believe that?
Yes.
Okay. Because I mean, between all the technology that's available and all the information out there, on a $400,000 house, what you're telling me, Fob, is I'm going to, let's just say 10% down, I'm going to put $40,000 on a down payment, right? I'm going to pay roughly another $14,000, $16,000 in closing. I don't know what the New Jersey state tax, you guys have freaked me out over there, by the way, 5% like property tax and crap. It was like, are you crazy?
Yeah.
I don't even know what the closing cost could be in New Jersey, right? On a $4,000 purchase with 10% down, right?
You can buy a $400,000 property with $10,000 in taxes.
Right.
So
it's insane.
You
it's
could
insane.
Be paying more. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So you're end up paying like about, say, $18,000 in closing cost.
That's if you're not paying points.
Right. Right. And you wouldn't because you're in the business. So you work out a deal.
Right. Of course. Of course.
And then on top of the $40,000 and the $18,000, you're going to pay your buying agent $12,000 for finding this house for you because they did a good job. Seriously, yeah. Maddie. I want you to really think about this for a second.
No, I'm not.
We're looking at. Right?
It's tough.
I mean, I hate to say this to all my buyer agents. I love you guys. I do. You know what I mean? But it's a very, very, we are walking into something that has no one considered.
Which I also, you know, as bad as that sounds, I also think it's good though, because again, I don't think any real estate agent goes into real estate wanting to be a buyer's agent, right? They're kind of like the hierarchy of real estate.
Back in the 90s and the 2000s, there was a guy, people who would they would not list properties. They would just get a bunch of buyers and they would sell 6, 8, 12, 14 buyers a month. And they're like, this is way easier than listing because now I don't got to be the one who's got a stage. I don't have to be the one to promote, blah, 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 blah. The other guy takes care of that. I just go show the houses and whatever then I go negotiate. And there was this one buyer down there, forget, in 95. And so he was literally charging fees before he would show houses. So,
I mean, I don't blame him though, because sometimes I'm like, I wish I got a consultation fee for someone that wastes my time with a pre-approval.
Right, right, right.
Our application fee isn't paid out, you know, until you close the loan. So you know how many hours you spend sometimes? And again, it's part of our job and whatever, but you know, looking through a pipeline right now, it's like, oh, this one's not ready. This one can't afford it, yada, yada, yada. But how much time and education did I give them? So and it's not their fault entirely, but it, you know.
So I was texting a mutual friend of ours. I'll share you the name afterwards, right? Mm-hmm. Last night, about 8:30 last night, right? And then I sent him this little text. I can share this with you guys. It's something from MBS Highway. And they were saying there are 435,000 new homes for sale at the end of September, right? Which is practically unchanged from last month, right? So this is new homes. I don't know what existing homes are looking like, right? And they responded, oh, shit. I responded, have to deploy new methods. They responded, OnlyFans?
Well, we're joking about this, but I have a lot of people that I know right now in our industry and in other industries, you know, related to what we do that are taking on second jobs, which Absolutely. Is also frustrating.
Yeah.
Because, again, it's like the balance of like, all right, well, we got to pay our own mortgages before, you know, like there's, you know, like obviously you have to do what you have to do, but I'm just noticing. So I have like one guy in my office was saying the other day, like one of his questions to new agents is like, do you do this for a living full time? Or is this something that's just like extra discretional money for you? Because unfortunately I'm not really interested in getting involved with someone that's not treating this as a full-time career.
Yeah. Look, I think we're walking through some stuff that I don't know. I mean, I hate to be the like the bearer of bad news, but I think we've been saying that this is a 24 to 36 month cycle that we're in. You know, and there's going to be no because you just can't instantly put a million houses on the market overnight.
No.
Or 90 days. Maybe you can. I don't know. Look, there's some Keith Cantor from First Community when I did the roundtable of the leadership a few months ago. He came with a really great idea. He said, you know, the government should waive I'm talking too fast. Capital gains on investment properties, like suspended for the next 24 months. And that might get some people to consider actually selling some investment properties that they've been holding on to that they don't even want to hold anymore.
Very smart.
Because of capital gains, they're not able to sell it. So we've got to incentivize it. Maybe we can incentivize people who are listing homes that are less than 250.
Right. You
know, give them a kind of
give them a grant or a down payment assistant on their next home. So right. It's an incentive to want to sell because that's the entire thing. I mean, not the entire thing right now, but one of the main things I'd say is like, I have so many people. So as you all know, I do a lot of first time home buyer purchases. And right now that hasn't been the shift for the last quarter. So first three quarters, yes. Last quarter, it's people that have bought homes or selling homes or are able to keep their current home as a secondary home or an investment property.
You got to remember, this is a cycle.
Yeah.
Right. So it's like you go into kindergarten. First grade, second grade, third grade. Here's a weird thing that no one ever thinks about when it comes to public education. You got to hope that the guys in 12th grade graduate and move out of the space.
Yeah.
If they start flunking and a certain percentage of them don't, there's going to be a bottleneck.
Yeah.
Because the still kids are still going to move up, but there won't be. It's the same thing we're having in housing. If people cannot buy their first-time home or they're afraid to sell their first-time home, right? Because they're like, dude, I'm not going to put my house on the market. I don't know.
It'll go in 5 minutes and I don't know where I'm going. Or I'm gonna,
What am I going to do, right?
Or they know that they wouldn't be able to afford within the same purchase range right. Now that the rate market has shifted. So they know.
Even if they got a 6% rate a year ago, whatever, right? I don't know what the rate, but like say, let's say it was 6% a year ago. Even if they got that, today they're looking at an 8% rate.
Yeah.
So why would they want to like move out of the area, hope that they qualify for a new loan, right? I mean, so it's a very unique situation we're in, man. I mean, all around there's uniqueness. But I want to say this to the audience. I also believe that there's solutions in this market. And I no one better to me than Madison to give us solutions and get us out of this market, Madison.
Put all our weight on. I'm like, oh, God.
Madison, it's up to you. The new generation of loan officers to get us out of this, because us old hodgers, I mean, we're not going to think of it.
I'll give a little slice of hope out there and I'll be, I mean, I'm always transparent, but like the beginning of this first quarter of this year, I did not close a single loan. My first closing of this year did not happen until April.
Wow.
But currently, right now, October, I have one more closing on Monday. This will be my biggest month of the year. So if I hadn't gone through the months of not making money and grinding and getting creative and trying to figure it out and kind of, you know, getting to that desperate period of time. I feel like that's where creativity stems and new ideas and innovation and a new way of, you know, we've been getting fed, like we've just been getting spoiled the last couple of years.
Right.
I feel like there's no hope for people right now because they've literally been sitting back, able to sit in their offices from, you know, 9 to 5, just kind of creating, you know, I don't know. There's just, for me, I guess coming into it in the craziness of everything, I've just always been trying to get creative because I was like, how do I capitalize on getting people to work with me while business is still booming? And now trying to figure out, okay, who's left? Because seriously, there's two agents that I worked with this year that I got a majority of my business from in quarter two and quarter three of this year. That are not in the business right now, Q4.
Wow.
Like two top producing agents.
So they're gone.
And that really also opened my eyes of like, I can't depend, again, comes back to the realtors. Like I got spoiled, you know, Q2 and Q3 with these guys. And then I got comfortable. And then when they left, that key player that was helping and feeding me kind of, you know, literally the cords were cut. They're no longer in the industry. By choice, you know, it wasn't because they were doing bad, But that really also kind of like made me pivot and like, okay, what did I do last year to get these agents who were top producers to want to work with me? So that's kind of been my shift this year, was like knowing what it was like not making money the first 3 months of the year.
Question. And if you could answer simply, that'd be great.
I know. I should take a breath for a second.
That'd be perfect. You know what I mean? Because it's like we all want simple answers, right?
I'm going to start looking at the top left corner of the screen where the timer is going.
All right. There you go. That's a good idea. Why not? I mean, it's just pretend you're in a presidential election debate. You know what I mean? So,
well, was that not a profound statement, though?
It was
an overran sentence.
The problem was that I don't know about the audience. I would imagine the audience is similar to me, right? I would think. We hear a couple of things and then it kind of like tunes out.
I think.
And then it's like Charlie Brown's teacher.
And then it goes what?
And it's like, okay, I understand what she's saying. But what I really want to know is, what did you do differently in starting April to start having October become like your best month?
Okay, so that's what I was, okay, yeah, that's where I was getting to, right? So no, but that was my background into it, of like, I wanted them to know that, like, okay, just like kind of putting it in focus with like right now, if you're not doing business right now, I just wanted to say like, I was there and now this month is my best month to date. So here's some things that I did when I was in that rut. Now I'm losing my focus.
They're so happy for you. Happy for you. It's a happy audience.
No. Yeah. Okay.
So what'd you do? Okay. What'd you do?
Now
what
I've
did you do?
Focus.
What'd you
I
do?
I'm joining the networking group. I go to open houses at
April?
Least. What? I'm telling you. Okay. In April. I mean, yeah. I'm part of other networking groups. This was just a new one that I joined that I brought up in the beginning.
You joined networking groups. Right?
Right. But they're not just real estate networking groups. So perfect. You can join your Chamber of Commerce. You can join things community oriented. I was doing network pop-up shops. So there's a girl that runs small owned businesses that come together 4 times a year and they get to promote their business, whether it's a product or a service. So I went into that knowing that it was going to be all self-employed individuals and business owners. And I pitched and promoted loans for self-employed individuals.
Nice.
I'm not going out there you can't go out there just promoting the same loan products that every other bank and mortgage company offers.
Right.
When I go and sit with my real estate agents, which I've talked about before, it's coffee appointments. If you're spending money on lunches and dinners and drinks and all this other stuff, you're wasting your time. You're investing in someone that you haven't even figured out if you even want to work with them yet. Mm-hmm. One of the main questions that I've been asking them recently is, what's one area of your business that you wish you could improve on? And then that's the thing that I help them with. So one of my agents right now, she needed help with accountability. She has so many people that she needs to call, but she doesn't hold herself accountable to making phone calls. So now twice a week, we got on a Zoom call in silence. So we just mute ourselves and we make calls for that hour.
Really? Hold on. That's pretty cool. So
yeah.
You guys are actually making calls on Zoom so the other person can actually see you making calls.
Mm-hmm.
Hold on. Hey, John, how are you?
Hey.
Welcome.
Did you hear what she just said?
John,
I heard. I came in.
I mean, I love this idea of being on a Zoom call, muting our microphone, and then watching you make phone calls for me.
I came in late when Madison said she joined the Just the Tip Club, which I didn't know. And then
it's not called Just the Tip.
It's called La Tip.
Oh, okay. And this is a way less interesting podcast than I thought it was.
Show, John, come on.
It's kind of like the La Freak. Remember La Freak?
Yeah, I remember La Freak. Right? Forget all this. I want Madison's take on the BioSig for NMLS. What's your take on BioSig?
When you're shaking and trying to do the same thing over and over again, and suddenly I forget how to write a number.
I knew you'd have a take.
PTSD, honestly.
How long does it take to do your BioSig?
well, this year they made me change it up. Like, I usually do the same one every year. And they were like, no, you have to do a new one. Right?
They said it was not. So here's the
weird thing. It had to be a combination of numbers and letters this year.
So here's the weird thing. They told me the same thing. And then I punched the same one in and they accepted it.
Yeah.
No, I had to throw an S in there instead of a 5. I figured, like, let's keep it.
I bet they think that my 0's an O.
Yeah.
Me is still a 0, but I guess they if they same like thing. It. So hold on. Madison, so Zoom call muted.
It's an accountability Zoom call.
I love it.
You're all watching each other in silence for an hour placing phone calls.
Yes. And if you look up and like they're on phone calls, like you're not going to sit there and just be like so you just, on, it, Madison, it literally forces Madison, you.
One thing though, if they're on mute, do you really know that they're calling? I mean, they could be just
That's on them.
I know, but it's
that's on them then. Then they're fooling themselves. I mean, I'm not their parent or their boss trying to be like, you have to make
see, look at John 10 phone calls. He's calling somebody, right? Look at that. See that?
Fobby just booked you an appointment.
See how that's the crap I got to deal with.
But we're not going on there calling people that we're even like, it's not like, okay, I'm going to call this list of leads that's going to work with us. It's like literally whatever phone calls you got. I mean, if you got to make a doctor's appointment in that hour, I don't care. And that holds you accountable and that helps your business. I don't know.
Okay. Okay. What else, Madison? What about something your dad said to us? Bag of donuts. Do you take
Joey donuts? Bag of donuts?
Do you take a bag of donuts?
Do I take? Yeah, no. I'm not really a big like bringing pastries into the office type of girl. Honestly, I feel like it's weird. Every time someone comes in our office and they're like handing out goodies, I'm like, okay, this like. These goodies come with like you wanting something from me or you expecting something from me. Like there's never been a time that someone walks in your office randomly and then they're like, oh, I work for this mortgage insurance company or I work for this insurance company.
Google me something. I need you to Google pastry kind of girl. Because that's what Madison said. She's I'm not a pastry kind of girl. Or no, Brittany a pastry kind of girl. That's kind of cool, man. I wonder what a pastry kind of girl is. So anyway,
I just described it. It's the mortgage insurance companies and the insurance companies that can't think of a more strategic way to come and ask for your business. So they bring a bunch of pastries into a office full of strangers. First of all, like I'm not eating pastries from strangers, ma'am. Well, if, and then second
like
of all,
what if someone's like a diabetic in the office?
Then good for them. Then they have their sweets if their sugar runs low. Not for me.
That's the right approach. So listen, Madison, you dropped some bombs on us, and I appreciate that. That was good. I do like that. And I'm gonna give you a song, all right? Because I think it's only fair when you share your knowledge with us that we support you. And I think John will appreciate the song. I don't know if you will, Madison.
Yeah, well, the clap felt a little sarcastic before, JP. He was being a little rude before. Made me completely lose my train of thought.
You know this song? Madison, this came out before you were born also. But me and JP grew up on this song.
We did?
This was like at every high school dance. We watched. Here we go. Right here, Madison. So from now on, whenever you drop the bomb on us, we're going to be playing that song for you.
The
Gap Band.
I mean, I got to tell you, man, this Zoom call with mute and calling, whoever is listening to this show right now, all 7 of you people, that's the one you got to take it and run with because that's going to make
you. Money. I'll give you one more unique one that's well, what on, I man. Consider hold unique.
On. Hold on. Ready?
Right, just going to drop another bomb.
All right, let's go for it.
Okay, so when you're going to open houses, this is an idea that I texted my realtor that I went to an open house with this week. So instead of doing our follow-ups where you're just going through the open house sheets or, you know, if you're either splitting them up with your agent or you're doing them for your agent, we're sending a video of ourselves at the open house thanking the people on the sign-up sheet for coming so that they remember our faces and they remember the house. if they're going and looking at multiple houses in one.
Give it up, ladies and gentlemen. That was amazing.
You are just being. I can't talk over all this noise tonight.
Dropped another bomb on us.
I almost wish it would go back to when the noise only played on your headphones.
I gotta tell you, I love having this new thing that we have. I just love it. It's a new toy. We're getting ready for the next season. You don't understand.
It's distracting. It's freaking distracting. I have ADHD. This is, I'm like trying to remember what I'm saying while listening to the buzzing in my ear and trying to auto-tune it out. And then you talking. Oh, look,
Maddie, we did not get through all your topics that you wanted to, but listen, guys, I am telling you, please, 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 Zoom calls with one another to hold each other accountable for phone calls. Golden nugget, Maddie. I'm not joking with you. I'm 30 years
that's
of
not my, and it's not. It's I can't take responsibility for this though. I'm gonna give
the,
a shot.
You're on the podcast right now, so you're gonna get 100% credit.
All right, thanks.
Think of that.
Nope.
Perfect.
So unfortunately, we hold each other accountable with no way of measuring.
And that's you just play distracting noises on a Zoom call instead of keeping the silence.
All right. Well, guys, we have come up to the end of this episode. I think we did a good episode. I think we talked about the issues, and Madison was able to give some hope and some solutions on how to get around these issues. Ultimately, that's what it's about. Whatever's going on in the market is going to change. Whatever goes up, goes down. Whatever goes down, goes up. And that's just the way this market is. We just got to ride it out right now. Right, Madison?
Right, Fob.
And until then, what do we say, Maddie?
JP, wrap it up.
I bumped him. I bumped.